While I've been stuck inside, I've been spending a lot of time thinking about what makes all of this livable. How does my home stay warm? Where does this electricity come from? Why is my dog so heckin' cute? How do the systems that support my internet connection and comfort impact the climate system? These are big questions, so I'm gonna start by just taking a tiny portion of that and looking at an often overlooked source of renewable energy and heating, geothermal and geoexchange. Now, as a heads up, a portion of this video has been supported by the Geothermal Exchange Organization, a trade association in the United States. But like all of my videos, the only person with editorial control is me. Strangely, the only person doing anything around here is me.
Why don't you pay rent?
Okay, the basics. Geothermal, like most renewables, comes in two major flavors, big and little. Big, we're talking geothermal power plants, industrial scale systems designed to pump out electricity for millions of people. Apparently people in the biz call these hot rocks.
Hot rocks.
On the opposite side of the spectrum, we've got the smaller scale residential systems that are referred to as geoexchange or geothermal heat pump systems. Both of these systems work on roughly the same principle that the temperatures below our feet are consistent throughout the year, unlike the atmosphere, which likes to mix it up a bit too much. But beyond the whole geo equals earth, thermal equals heat thing, these two types of systems are pretty different. I'm gonna dig into both types of geothermal this video, but let's start with the big ones.
Hot rocks.
The deeper underground you go, the warmer it gets. The center of the planet is the same temperature as the surface of the sun. The deepest hole we've ever dug into the earth was 12 kilometers, which isn't even 1% of the way to the center, but still it was as hot as an oven. So hot we had to stop digging. So here's a question. In a time where we're desperate for non-carbon emitting energy sources, why aren't we using the heat beneath our feet? With the right geology, chemistry, and drilled wells, you can send water down to where it is warm, heat it up with all that geothermal heat, then pump the water back to the surface, nice and toasty, make some steam and spin a turbine. Geothermal power is generated in a pretty similar way to other types of thermal generation. Thermal generation is just a fancy word for boiling some water and spinning a turbine. At a gas power plant, you burn gas to boil water to create steam that spins a turbine. At a coal power plant, you burn coal to boil water to create steam to spin a turbine. A nuclear plant? A little more complicated, but same deal. You do some fission, which boils a liquid to create steam to spin a turbine. Geothermal says, what if instead of burning anything, we just look down there? One of the big things that makes geothermal different from other renewables, it isn't variable. The temperatures downstairs does not change, so it can provide baseload power in ways that solar and wind can't. You need pretty specific geology to make this kind of power generation work, and drilling holes into the ground that deep is wicked expensive. So in a lot of places, despite the Earth's heat being free, the upfront costs are too high to compete with other cheaper forms of generating power. So right now, it's estimated that only 6 to 7% of the world's potential geothermal power has been tapped. Although some folks I spoke with said some of the lowest hanging fruit, the easiest and cheapest geothermal fields to take advantage of, are already being used, so ramping up production is technologically and monetarily difficult. Historically, in the US and North America, geothermal hasn't gotten a lot of love from the big environmental groups because of its connection with oil and gas. While geothermal is a renewable source of power, the tools and technologies and expertise to drill deep into the Earth's surface come from the oil industry that got good at this stuff looking for oil and fracking. Oil companies have also used geothermal to pretend like they cared about the planet, then dumped the projects. Looking at you, Chevron. The flip side of that, geothermal faces a lot of competition from the oil and gas industry when trying to recruit workers and getting the tech to drill and build these systems. That being said, Project Drawdown, the big book on climate solutions, says geothermal power has the potential to reduce global carbon dioxide emissions by 6.19 to 9.85 gigatons, which is quite a bit, but comes with a hefty initial price tag of over $80 billion. However, once the holes are drilled and the system is running, geothermal is basically free, and Project Drawdown estimates a lifetime net savings around $1 trillion. So that's your crash course in large-scale geothermal power production. But let's bring the temperature down and talk about geothermal exchange systems. These don't need super hot rocks by volcanoes to function. I spoke with Ryan Docherty from the Geothermal Exchange Organization about the potential for residential geothermal, especially in the United States.
Unlike high-temperature geothermal energy production, this is a 50-state technology, and it's installed in every state. The Cold Climate Research Center in Fairbanks, Alaska, is on a geothermal heat pump. Where I'm at in Springfield, Illinois, when Abraham Lincoln's tomb is on a geothermal system. The gift shop at the Statue of Liberty, St. Patrick's Cathedral in Manhattan, state capitals of Colorado, Oklahoma, and Michigan. On and on and on. There's IKEAs in Kansas City and in Denver that are 100 plus thousand square foot big box stores that are on geothermal systems. Our assessment is that there are probably a little over 1 million of these systems in operation. And the Department of Energy calculated that there are the equivalent of 2 million U.S. homes on geothermal. Their vision for the future of this technology is to see it deployed in the equivalent of 28 million homes by 2050. So a 14-fold increase in the next 30 years, which we are going to do our darndest to make happen. In my mind, this isn't optional. It's something we have to do. The question is, how fast can we get there?
The reason these geothermal heat pump systems work from New York City to rural Indiana to the suburb in your favorite TV show is because a few feet underground, the temperature is between 50 and 60 degrees Fahrenheit all the time. Essentially, a geothermal system transfers heat to or from the ground. In the winter, when the ground is generally warmer than the air, it pulls heat into the home. And in the summer, it can take the heat from the home and store it in the ground in exchange for the cooler subsurface temps. This is done with a series of pipes either laid horizontally or vertically underground, often called a ground loop, that's connected to a geothermal heat pump. The tech in a heat pump isn't that different from a refrigerator or an air conditioner, which basically just moves hot air around. The elegant solution that geothermal offers with this unlimited supply of 50 degree Fahrenheit heat just a few feet underground is that it is way more efficient. It is a lot easier to heat only 20 degrees, from 50 to a more comfortable 70, than it is to try to warm up the chilly outside air. Now, if you're like me and you never put too much thought into the big boiler in the basement or how your radiators work, or in my case, don't, the joys of living in New York City, you might be curious how this is any different from what a lot of homes have. I don't want to spend the extra brain cells to figure out a fossil fuel thing because I don't have to. What if we just call my dad and have him explain it? Cool? Cool.
Hello, Miriam.
Hi, Dad. Can I make you tell me about how we heat our house?
Well, first we plant the seeds for the tree, and then we wait a couple billion years for the oil.
What if you speed it up a little bit more?
So we have two heating systems. We have our original heating system, which is oil cooks water in a boiler, and boiling water is sent through radiators throughout the house. But we added a split system, which is based on electricity, where the unit is mostly outside.
Why didn't you get a geothermal one instead of an outside air compressor?
Because we're on a hill filled with lots of mud.
Talk to you later.
All right, take care.
Bye.
Bye.
So yeah, where I grew up, we had a big truck show up twice a year and pour a highly flammable gas into a steel drum. We then burn that gas in our home to stay warm. And this is apparently totally normal, but there are serious health ramifications. Indoor air pollution is a big deal. And then there are the carbon emissions. While transportation and energy generation get a lot of screen time because of their emissions, home and buildings, especially the heating and cooling of those buildings, is a huge generator of emissions. Geothermal heat pump systems fix that. They rely on this free, basically thermal battery below our feet. And while they do require electricity, they are by far the greenest home heating and cooling solution out there. So why doesn't everyone have one of these? Simple answer, they're expensive, and most people don't even know about geothermal. It's kind of like solar 10 or 15 years ago. The only people who even really knew about solar panels are engineers that want to tinker, really rich environmentalists, and people that just want to be completely off-grid. Even now, residential solar is not as widespread as it could be because it's still pretty expensive for most people. And unfortunately, unlike a solar panel, you don't get the same visual marketing. A house with a geothermal system looks no different than one with a gas boiler. But like solar, prices are coming down and governments and utilities are offering tax incentives and rebates. In a lot of places, installing a geothermal system can pay for itself in just a few years. And if you're building something new, the difference in cost is basically negligible. Reducing carbon emissions requires getting rid of fossil fuels. That needs to be done in three ways, which fortunately can all happen at the same time. One, clean up energy production. No more coal and gas making electricity. Two, electrify everything that requires fossil fuels. And three, reduce electricity consumption. Geothermal can play a part at each and every one of those stages. Large-scale industrial geothermal power generation can provide necessary baseload power, and geothermal heat pump systems can reduce energy demand and electrify heating and cooling of buildings. There isn't a world where global carbon emissions go down without seriously addressing the emissions from heating and cooling homes and buildings. Right now, geothermal is probably the best solution to do that. And in the future, geothermal systems are gonna get really cool. Some already are, depending on the definition of cool. The same concept that is used to heat and cool an individual home can be used for massive buildings, but it can also be networked. Imagine taking all the excess heat produced by trying to keep things cool in a supermarket and using that to heat your home. Right now, all that heat just gets vented off their roof. Incorporating geothermal into urban and suburban and even rural planning is going to need to be a major component in reducing emissions. Now, I'm not under the illusion that by seeing this video, you're about to throw out the boiler in your basement. Probably because, like me, you don't own that boiler and have no control over it. But you probably live somewhere, and that somewhere probably has a government body, which means you can talk to your legislators about incentivizing geothermal systems in construction, incorporating these systems into future developments, and get more people talking about this underground renewable. As always, I've left loads of links in the description down below if you want to learn more about geothermal. Thanks so much for watching. Bye. Hey, pup.